Welcome everyone to the recorded webinar series on LED-based photoacoustic imaging. My name is Mithun and I'm a research and business development manager at Cyberdyne. In this series, several key opinion leaders in the field of photoacoustics will talk about LED-based photoacoustic imaging and its preclinical and clinical applications. Today's exciting talk will be about the application of LED-based photoacoustic imaging in preclinical cancer research and will be delivered by Dr. Srivallisha Mallidi, who is an assistant professor at Tufts University. Dr. Mallidi received her master's and PhD degree in biomedical engineering from the University of Texas at Austin. Her graduate work was focused on molecular-specific photoacoustic imaging to understand nanomolecular interactions. She received New Investigator Award from the Central Texas Clinical Research Forum for this work. After graduation, she joined Willman Center for Photomedicine at Massachusetts General Hospital, Harvard Medical School as a postdoctoral fellow. She won several awards during her postdoctoral tenure at MGH, including the Young Investigator Award at the Frontiers in Biomedical Imaging Science Symposium held at Vanderbilt University. She was also awarded the American Society of Lasers in Medicine and Surgery Research Award for junior faculty. Currently, Dr. Mallidi is an assistant professor at Department of Biomedical Engineering at Tufts University, and she directs the Integrated Biofunctional Imaging Lab that focuses on ultrasound and photoacoustic imaging-based therapeutic strategies. In this webinar, she will talk about the potential of LED-based photoacoustic imaging in preclinical cancer research. With that, I will turn it over to Dr. Srivallisha Mallidi.
Hello everyone, I'm Srivallisha Mallidi. I direct the Integrated Biofunctional Imaging and Therapeutics Lab at Tufts University in Boston. Today I'll be presenting about LED light emitting diodes based photoacoustic imaging system, a low cost imaging system for preclinical cancer research. Several imaging modalities are used preclinically and clinically to understand tumor function and its response to treatment, particularly tumor volume, function, vascular density, vascular perfusion, and molecular information are key to understand treatment response. I show here on the x-axis the spatial resolution of these imaging modalities, and on the y-axis, the penetration depth that's achievable using these imaging modalities. MRI, CT, PET, and SPECT have very high penetration depth in the body, but lack good spatial resolution. Microscopy and OCT, on the other hand, have very good spatial resolution, but cannot penetrate deeper into the body. Ultrasound imaging falls in the mesoscale, where there is good spatial resolution, but also good penetration depth in the body. Furthermore, the advantage with ultrasound imaging is that it can produce images in real time. So in preclinical research, while we are trying to evaluate different therapies or trying to look at different preclinical tumor models, it is important to understand the tumor volume, structural information, and also the functional information of the tumor. Functional as in the blood vessel density, the molecular information as well is key to know about these tumors and image them longitudinally at different time points. It is very important in cancer research to understand, along with the structural properties, the functional properties of the tumor, particularly the vascular density, the vascular perfusion, and along with some molecular information will be very key to understand the tumor response to a particular treatment. While ultrasound imaging can provide the structural information in three dimensions and also to a certain extent the vascular information using the Doppler modalities available in ultrasound, what we are also interested in our lab is to look at blood oxygen saturation. Blood oxygen saturation is defined as the ratio of oxygenated hemoglobin to the total hemoglobin in the blood of that particular blood vessel. And we are interested to look at how oxygen saturation changes as a response to treatment. Oxygenated and deoxygenated hemoglobin have different optical absorption properties, as shown here. On the x-axis is the wavelength, and on the y-axis is the absorption coefficient of oxygenated or deoxygenated hemoglobin. oxygenated hemoglobin shown in the red curve here and deoxygenated hemoglobin shown in the blue curve here. So if we image at multiple wavelengths, we can tease out what is the oxygenated and deoxygenated hemoglobin concentration and thereby calculate the oxygen saturation value of a particular blood vessel. So overall, using the optical imaging techniques, we can tease out the vascular oxygen saturation of a particular blood vessel. And at the same time, if we take the salient features of ultrasound imaging in providing the structure, we combine those two properties to get photoacoustic imaging, which is nothing but light photo is generating sound. It is a non-ionizing, non-invasive, or minimally invasive imaging modality that can provide functional information along with the structural information provided by ultrasound imaging at a good spatial resolution and at a decent penetration depth. So combining ultrasound and photoacoustic imaging will provide both structural and also functional properties of the tumor. So in photoacoustic imaging, just as the name sounds, it involves an optical excitation of the tissue. So let's assume we have a scattering tissue with an absorber here shown in the black circle. Let's assume that's a blood vessel that will absorb the laser light. So the tissue is excited with a nanosecond pulsed laser, and that laser energy is then absorbed, which causes a local increase in temperature and a thermoelastic expansion and contraction, which gives a rise to the photoacoustic pressure wave that is then detected by the transducer. The same transducer that is used for ultrasound imaging can also be used for detecting the photoacoustic signals. So once these signals are detected by the transducer, they can be converted to a photoacoustic image shown here, where we see the signal, photoacoustic signal, only from the blood vessel, but the surrounding scattering tissue does not have any photoacoustic signal. So photoacoustic signal pressure or the amplitude of the photoacoustic signal is dependent upon the optical absorption properties and also the fluence that we that is input into the tissue. So all of this is also dependent as a function of depth shown here in Z. So we can image similar to an ultrasound in depth. We can obtain the oxygen saturation values if we use different wavelengths of optical excitation. Going back to the graph that shows the penetration depth and the spatial resolution of imaging modalities, we can clearly see here that photoacoustic imaging has good spatial resolution and also decent penetration depth. So ultrasound image, along with the photoacoustic imaging, can provide structural as well as functional information on the tumors without the use of any exogenous contrast agents. If we use contrast agents that are targeted to a particular biomarker in the tumor, we can also obtain molecular information on these tumors. Furthermore, as we increase the transducer frequency, we can increase the resolution of ultrasound and photoacoustic imaging. However, the caveat here is that we lose the penetration depth. So depending upon the application, a particular frequency transducer can be chosen to obtain a certain resolution and a certain penetration depth. So overall, as we have seen, photoacoustic signal is proportional to the optical absorption coefficient of the blood. And by performing multi-wavelength photoacoustic imaging, we can get the morphology, which is the structure, using the ultrasound images in 3D. We can obtain the tumor volume and the shape and size of these tumors in several preclinical models. And we can also obtain at the same cross-section the vascular density and also the blood oxygen saturation of those blood vessels. So, as we have seen previously, for photoacoustic imaging, we need a nanosecond pulsed laser excitation. Majorly, the nanosecond pulsed lasers are very expensive. What we'll be talking about today is LED-based photoacoustic imaging. And LEDs are safe, they are high throughput, they are low cost, and can pulse at a much higher repetition rate than the lasers that are available currently in the market. So the advantages of LED-based photoacoustic imaging, as you would have seen in the other talks in this session, will be low cost, high throughput, and given they are LEDs, will be patient and operator safe and can have a smaller footprint to generate a mobile system and also is accessible at a low cost to several researchers. In our research, we are interested in the changes in vascularity of the tumors and oxygen saturation before and after the treatment, longitudinally, to be able to monitor these changes with different treatments. And AcousticX, which is an LED-based photoacoustic imaging system from CyberDyne Inc., the organizers of this webinar series, facilitated imaging vasculature in real time in preclinical mouse models, which is what I'll show in the next results now. So overall, the last few years, there have been several papers using the AcousticX system and it was used for imaging blood vessels in different rheumatoid arthritis models and also several phantom models. What we will be focusing here is to use that LED-based photoacoustic system for preclinical cancer research. So what we have is a 7 megahertz transducer, which is a 128 element transducer. And we've used in our research 850 nanometer LED arrays. At 850 nanometers, the penetration depth in the body is much deeper than at other wavelengths. So to achieve or to actually image the whole tumor in a mouse model, we used 850 nanometer wavelength and 4 kilohertz pulse repetition rate. The standard lasers operate at either 10, 20, or 100 hertz. Here we are operating the LEDs at 4 kilohertz, which will enable real-time photoacoustic imaging. The axial resolution of the system is based on the transducer that we are using, which is about 220 micron axial resolution and at about 460 microns lateral resolution. And we placed the LED arrays at an angle of 48.6 degrees to the transducer. The tumor model that we used is a subcutaneous tumor model that is implanted using FADU squamous cell carcinomas. And then 10 days post-implantation, the tumor grew to a size of about 6 to 8 millimeters in diameter. What you see here is a photograph of such a tumor. We placed the transducer at the location shown by this particular black line. The X and Y is the plane of the slide or the screen that you're seeing, and Z is into the axis into the depth of the tumor. So if we look at a particular cross section using the acoustic imaging, acoustic X imaging system, shown here in grayscale is the ultrasound image. So we can clearly see the tumor, the subcutaneous tumor shown here. The skin is hyperechoic and the tumor is hypoechoic as shown here. And the photoacoustic image is obtained where there are blood vessels. So we see high photoacoustic signal on the location of the blood vessels. And wherever there are no blood vessels, we do not see any photoacoustic signal across the same cross-section as we obtained the ultrasound images. So we can clearly see here a particular blood vessel, very high photoacoustic signal indicating a blood vessel in that location. A couple of smaller blood vessels here on the bottom of the tumor. And these are the blood vessels that feed the subcutaneous tumor from underneath. Since we have a 4 kilohertz repetition rate LED photoacoustic imaging system, we can obtain images at a very high frame rate. Obviously, LEDs operate at a low energy than the traditional lasers, so the signal-to-noise ratio can be low. However, because we are doing such high frame rate imaging, by averaging several frames, we can get very good signal-to-noise ratio. The next image that I show you here is of the tumor obtained at different frame rates. Here, if a slower frame rate, as such as the 0.31 hertz, means that we averaged several frames together, and obviously the noise levels here are reduced, and we can clearly see the minor blood vessels in the center of the tumor as well. If we go with a higher frame rate, such as a 60 hertz shown here, we can actually see there's a lot of noise levels. So because of this high repetition rate, it's actually an advantage that we can average, even though we have low power from the LEDs, we can average several frames and obtain a decent signal to noise ratio. Example movies of the real-time imaging with the mouse breathing motion that you can see here are shown in these two movies. Here is a 15 hertz movie, and here is a movie of the mouse tumor obtained at 30 hertz. Also, what we see here in the graphs below is that as we average the number of frames, the signal-to-noise ratio is also improving. Overall, because of this feature, we can do real-time imaging, but also we can scan the transducer across the tumor to obtain three-dimensional images of the tumor. So shown here is the mouse, and then the transducer is placed across the tumor as shown by the black line here. We scan the tumor and we can obtain three-dimensional images. So shown here is an overlay of the ultrasound image shown in the grayscale, and the photoacoustic image is overlaid on top of the ultrasound image. We can clearly see a lot of blood vessels on the top of the tumor. A major blood vessel that is feeding the tumor from the side here into the tumor can be clearly seen in this three-dimensional, in this scan of several B scans put together here. From these several B scan images, we can generate a three-dimensional movie shown here, on where you can clearly see a lot of blood vessels that are feeding the tumor. So our next step was, we are able to see the blood vessels. Can we validate that with histology? So what we ended up doing is, across the same cross-section, perform histology of the tumor and look at blood vessel CD31 marker. So we correlated the photoacoustic images with histology. Shown here is an ultrasound image in the grayscale overlaid with photoacoustic image shown in pseudo color map, where blue represents low photoacoustic signal and red represents high photoacoustic signal. We obtained the HND image, which is essentially a structural image of the tumor. And you can actually see there's a good correlation between the structure of the HND image and also the tumor shown from the ultrasound image. And across the same cross-section, the adjacent slide was stained with DAPI for the nucleus and CD31, which essentially demarcates the blood vessels in the tumor shown here in red. So what we see here is a lot of blood vessel density in the bottom of the tumor and also on the top and the top left side of the tumor. So if we look at the images qualitatively, we can clearly see a lot of blood vessels here in the images, and also at the bottom of the tumor, there is a lot of high photoacoustic signal indicative of the high blood vessel density in the tumor cross-section. An example is shown here with the yellow arrows of the regions that have high photoacoustic signal and high blood vessel density from the histology. Another mouse tumor shown here, we have high photoacoustic signal in the top shown here, as well as you can see a high red signal on the mouse tumor shown in the immunofluorescence image. Blood vessels on the bottom and on the side of the tumors, very less blood vessels in the center region of this particular tumor. And you can actually see there is not many blood vessels in the center region of this tumor. So there is good qualitative correlation between the photoacoustic images obtained from the LED acoustic X system and the immunofluorescence images. Going further, we wanted to quantitatively correlate the photoacoustic images with the histology. So what we did is imaged several tumors, slides, cross sections, and obtained the photoacoustic images first, euthanized the mouse, did several cross sections, stained them, and used a whole slide scanner to obtain the CD31 and also the DAPI information. We performed a threshold analysis to demarcate the blood vessel region from the immunofluorescence images. And then the post-process images were then compared to the photoacoustic signal images. So we chose several regions of interest. The same area within the ultrasound photoacoustic image was matched to the immunofluorescence images. And we summed the photoacoustic signal in these areas and summed the immunofluorescence signal in the post-processed images, and did that for several mice across different cross sections, and plotted a graph where we have the photoacoustic signal sum in those ROIs on the x-axis and the immunofluorescence CD31 positive pixels in the y-axis. So here is shown one color dot, which is the green color dot for one mouse. And then we repeated that for several other mice as well and obtained an R-square value of 0.62, a good correlation between the photoacoustic signal and also the immunofluorescent signal. Obviously, when you have low photoacoustic signal, the blood vessel density is low. And when we have high photoacoustic signal, we do actually see high values in the CD31 marker in the immunofluorescence. So this correlation can further be improved by using a high frequency transducer. Obviously, in our study, we use 7 megahertz transducer, which has the axial resolution about 250 micron and lateral resolution about 460. So if we use a high frequency transducer, the resolution will be much better, which can then enable us to see the microvessels much better than the current frequency transducer that we are using. We can also improve on LED irradiation geometry. We currently had a fixed LED angle, so we are working on optimizing the LED irradiation geometry. If we have contrast agents that are targeted to a particular molecular marker in the tumors, we can also do molecular imaging using acoustic X imaging system. So what you see here is that we injected a dye that is targeted to a particular biomarker, in this case, it is epidermal growth factor receptor, into the tumor directly. The dye absorbed at 850 nanometers. So we can see here, this is before the injection of the dye into the tumor. So the grayscale is the ultrasound image, and the photoacoustic image that represents the blood vessels is shown here. So obviously, before injection of the dye, we do see some contrast from the blood vessels. But as soon as we inject the dye, you can actually see increased photoacoustic contrast in certain regions of the tumor, indicating that the dye is accumulating in those regions. So if we have molecular targeted contrast agents, we can use acoustic X and photoacoustic imaging to look at the molecular information of these tumors as well. The acoustic system comes with multi-wavelength LED arrays as well, such as 750 and 850 nanometer LED arrays, using which we can do oxygen saturation mapping across a particular tumor. In this case, we are showing you a photoacoustic image of a mouse hind leg where the mouse is breathing either oxygen or air. So as the mouse is breathing different anesthesia gases, the oxygen saturation in the blood vessels of the leg will change. So you can see here, the ultrasound image is shown in grayscale of the mouse leg. And this is when, during cycle one, when the mouse is breathing air. And in the cycle two, where the mouse is breathing 100% oxygen, you can actually see the oxygen saturation increases. It's shown in red here. So blue is low oxygen levels and red is high oxygen levels. So you can see in the first case where the mouse is breathing air, the oxygenation levels are yellow. But when the mouse is breathing 100% oxygen, the oxygen saturation of the blood vessel increases. So it's shown in red here. And over time, we can actually, as we are changing the breathing gas, we can actually see the oxygen saturation changing in these blood vessels over time. So our next steps are using the multi-wavelength LED arrays to image oxygen saturation changes in the tumor as a response to different kinds of treatments. So in summary, I've shown that real-time imaging of vasculature in subcutaneous tumors using LED-based photoacoustic imaging is possible. There is a good correlation between LED-based photoacoustic imaging and immunofluorescence and histological techniques. Image enhancement can be done using contrast agents, and molecular imaging is possible. And we can also do oxygen-enhanced LED PAI, which is, you know, changing the breathing oxygen of the mouse. And we can also look at the oxygen saturation changes in the tumor as a function of treatment. And improving the light delivery can also improve better the signal-to-noise ratio and the image quality. And an example of the tumor oxygen saturation with multi-wavelength LED arrays is shown here. Clearly in this particular tumor, you can see red is the highly oxygenated areas, blue is the hypoxic or the low oxygenated areas. This particular tumor seems to be very highly oxygenated across all of the blood vessels. So we are trying to optimize the imaging system furthermore to obtain oxygen saturation. Oxygen saturation of the blood vessels in the tumor, and then correlate that with hypoxia markers in the immunohistochemistry procedure. So with that, I would like to thank the IBIT lab members, specifically Marvin Xavier Selwan, shown here. He has been instrumental in doing all of the experiments that I showed in this talk, and the funding sources and the PhotoPath lab at Mass General Hospital for allowing us to use their whole slide scanner. And I would also like to thank Cyberdyne Inc. for giving me the opportunity to present in these webinar series, and particularly Dr. Singh for providing this opportunity to present our work. Several publications from our lab using the Acoustic X are now published. And the work that I presented here is published in Sensors. We also published a book chapter that talks about LED-based photoacoustic imaging and how it is an affordable solution for preclinical cancer imaging. And if any questions, feel free to reach out to me at srivalisha.malidi@tufts.edu. Thank you so much.